This session is actually session number 3 in our current series of how to use your mind as a time machine to create more of the life that you want. Just as you came on here, I was telling Jessica, so when I went to Bournemouth, I had planned to do my introductory, and then I was going to do a one-day workshop later, but that ended up getting canceled. So last week, because I had that Bournemouth talk in my head, the intro, you know, the introductory talk, last week's session was more or less a follow-up to that. So the way that I originally sort of thought about this was I talked about going to Bournemouth for a week or two before I left. And then I did the thing in Bournemouth, and then I was going to talk about it when I came back, which is what happened last week, right? And so when I was looking at last week's recording, I mentioned this to Jessica a minute ago, I realized, oh, this is kind of what I wanted to do with my one-day workshop in Bournemouth. You know, the talk was about your mind as a time machine and how I discovered mental time travel and had this dream and all that, you know, stuff. And then the one-day workshop was going to be, okay, here's what you do with it. Here's how you use it, right? But I never got to do that in Bournemouth. But last week, that's what we ended up doing, or that's what I ended up doing, more or less, was saying, okay, you know, now you got, this is kind of part two, right? The introductory talk I did was like the intro, and then here's the workshop, here's how you use it. So last week, I think, was very good. I just posted it yesterday, Naomi, so you might not have seen it, but I think it's good because what we started talking about was editing. You know, Greg brought up this idea of editing, right? And so I talked a little bit about editing, and then I sort of got into editing and why editing is so important, and why, you know, the essence of writing is really rewriting, you know, because when you do any writing, I mean, you, if you're a person who keeps a diary, you might even have this experience too. I'm not sure. I've never sort of kept a diary, but certainly when you're writing something, especially if it's anything substantial, you know, the secret to the whole thing is rewriting. And when you're rewriting, what you are doing is you're trying to figure out what you're trying to say. Right? So when you first hear that, you might say, well, if you don't know what you're trying to say, then what are you doing writing in the first place? But writing is a creative act, right? If you're writing a book or you're writing a play or, you know, anything that you're writing. So lots of people that write, I'm talking about professionals, you know, professional authors, right? People that write, you know, they oftentimes don't know where the thing is going. Like Stephen King, he says, for example, he can't imagine why anybody would know how the story is going to end up when they start. Like, it doesn't make any sense to him. He says what he does is he creates a couple of characters and he creates a situation, and then he just lets the people go. And he just watches what they do and he writes it down. So he doesn't know how the story is going to unfold until it happens. And he says lots of times the characters do things that he didn't expect. So that's one approach. The other approach, of course, is people that have something figured out in advance. And so they sort of have the plot of the thing, whatever they're doing, if it's a play or a movie or a story, you know, they sort of know where they're going. And the rewriting is all about how do you get there? I know I'm going to tell the story about this crime, you know, but how do I get there? So you have all these different pieces. And so you're writing and writing and rewriting and rewriting and rewriting. And it's not unusual for someone to take years to write a story, like write a book, right? I mean, I spent 15 years writing my book on and off. And because it was complicated, right? So the idea, the point that I'm trying to make here is that what you realize at some point is that what you're doing is you're channeling something. As a matter of fact, William Gibson, who you might know, he's a famous science fiction writer. He wrote Necromancer, and or at least Neuromancer, and he's written a couple of, you know, really popular novels. He says writing is channeling. He said, I'm the person who made a commitment to show up every day and take dictation from the person who's actually writing the book. He said, I don't write the books. I just show up and write down what the person who's actually writing the books says. And he said, some days he doesn't show up and I just sit there, you know. But when he shows up, I write it all down. So that's the creative process, right? I mean, if you think about somebody who's writing a song or writing a piece of music or writing a symphony, they often say, I didn't know where it was going when I started, you know, or maybe I started with a riff and then I added words to it later and then I added a melody to it and I added a chorus, you know what I mean? Like, they don't know where it's going when they begin. And so that's true for so many things. That when you begin a project, you don't know where it's going. So so for me, this story of having this dream and trying to figure it out and then realizing the importance of it and how it worked and what it meant. And then starting, you know, teaching it to other people. That's basically been a process that I've been involved in since I was 10. You know, more or less. I mean, certainly starting in my early 30s when I started to write and do some workshops, right? So when I was listening to that talk I gave in Bournemouth, I realized, and I mentioned this last week, I realized, oh, that's what I'm trying to say, right? You know, you're kind of trying to say something. You're not quite sure what you're trying to say. And so you're trying to figure a way to say it, and then you listen to it later. And this is why I tell anybody who's doing any kind of writing or teaching or anything, record everything you do, because it's only in the listening of it that you can figure out what's going on. Oh, that's what I'm trying to say, right? So what happened last week when we did our call last week was I covered a few of the things that I thought, this is what I'm trying to say, you know, and Greg loved it. And I think all of us loved it too. It was really good. So I encourage you to listen to last week's thing, which, as I mentioned to Jessica, when we first started here, it's kind of part two of the introductory talk I gave in Bournemouth, right? So the talk I did in England is the introducing the idea that your mind is a time machine and thinking is a connection, right? And then what we did last Saturday, or what I did last Saturday, was filled in a few of the blanks. What does it mean, right? And so when I was listening and editing last week's session, I realized, oh, there's a couple of pieces here that I missed, right? And this is quite a common experience for me. And like I say, any creative person, you know, I mean, think of an artist. I mean, they'll take a blank canvas and they'll start to paint, and they might not know what they're going to end up with, right? They start something and then they think, oh, I'll add a little bit here, or I'll put a little more there, or I'll, you know, cover it up and start again, you know. So this idea of kind of trying to figure out what you're channeling, you know, what's this message that you're getting from your subconscious or wherever it's coming from, right? That's kind of the, you know, the never-ending process. So one of the things I mentioned last week, and I was talking about this, and I realized I didn't finish the story. I didn't finish what I was talking about. So so I'll just talk about it now. And that was when I did that meditation exercise when I was around 32. I did that for a couple months. I started by trying to remember something positive in my childhood, because I couldn't remember anything positive. Whenever I thought about the past, all I got was a whole bunch of negative stuff. You know, frustration, anger, feeling ripped off, cheated, misunderstood, you know, confused, and that sort of thing. So, but after a couple months, I started to remember all sorts of positive things. I started with that baseball game, right? And then I remembered more and more about that baseball game. And then eventually I remembered that day when I left after the baseball game, I fell asleep and I had this dream and saw myself at 32. That was my big aha, right? When I realized, oh, thinking is a connection. You know, we think of memory like kind of like a recording. But I realized memory is not a recording. What it is a connection, right? So the next thing was, and this is, I started to tell this story last week, and I sort of lost the thread of what I was going to mention, because we got into talking about memory. So I said, for example, you know, if thinking is a connection, if memory is a connection, then I'm going to be able to remember today, 5 years from now. So 5 years from now, I'm going to be able to remember what I'm doing today, right? So therefore, the information from 5 years from now must be available to me right now. Because thinking is a connection. And I had just proven to myself that, you know, after 2 months of doing this meditation and remembering the baseball game and remembering that summer when I was playing with my friends and living in this little town in Nova Scotia, all this information was there, right? And one of the things that I said last week was, you know, if you use the analogy of a phone call as a connection, which is what I've often used when you're thinking of the past, you're making a connection, right? And when you're thinking of the future, you're making a connection. So a memory is a connection. And if you talk on the phone to somebody for an hour, you're going to get all kinds of information from them. But if you talk to them for 10 hours, you're going to get 10 times the amount of information. Right? I mean, you know, it's obvious, right? So if the future and the past are connected, then I should have information about what I'm going to be doing, let's say 5 years from now. The information should be available to me right now. Because now and 5 years from now are connected, right? So that was when I had this huge insight that, that's the reason that we set goals. That's why Paul Meyer's goal-setting process is so powerful. Because the more you clarify your goals, the more information you're getting from that time when you're when you've achieved your goal, right? And so when you're working in that workbook, what you're really doing is you're using your intuition to connect with the future and try and figure out, what is my life like 5 years from now? What am I doing? Where am I living? Who am I with? What's going on, you know? Do you understand? So I realized this when I was working in that workbook. When I started working in that goal-setting workbook. What are your dreams? What are your goals? You know, what do you want 5 years from now in all six areas of your life? And it was just a fantasy. I was just saying, okay, I want this, and I want that, and I want this, and I want that, you know, whatever, right? And it was really tedious, and it was really boring. And I gave up a couple times. I just put the workbook aside and stopped playing in it. But then when I had that insight that really what I'm doing is I'm reading the future. I'm using my, if you might want to call it, psychic ability to figure out what's going to happen in 5 years' time. Where am I living? Where am I working? What am I doing? What's my health like? What's my relationship like? You know, whatever, right? So that shift in emphasis, you know, from looking at working in the workbook as working from the present toward the future. What I started to do was to try and read what my future self is doing. Right? So it's kind of different focus. Listening to the future, in a sense, as opposed to just writing down ideas, you know? And so that's what I was going to mention last week, but I got sidetracked because we were talking about, I mentioned, you know, the person who has the most information about the past is a person who keeps a diary. If you keep a diary every day, then you're going to be able to go back to a year ago and you're going to be able to remember what you did a year ago because you wrote it down, right? Well, think about that workbook as a diary of your future. Puts a whole different spin on it, right? And so when I got the idea of going to England and doing a talk there, at first it was just a concept in my head, right? Oh, you know, that'd be a fun thing to do. How can I do that? How could I set that up, right? So what I did was I just, you know, asked my future self, okay, here I am, I'm in England, I'm talking, I have an audience here, I'm talking about mental time travel. How did I set this up? And the answer came, oh, well, how I set this up was I wrote an email and sent it to a bunch of positive thinking groups and asked them if they wanted me to come and talk here. And these people said yes. So that's why I'm here. Well, that's literally what happened. I mean, literally, that's what happened. So I thought, hey, that's a good idea, you know. So that's when I wrote this email and I sent it to all these positive thinking groups. And I ended up with the people in Bournemouth saying, yeah, we'd like to have you do a talk here. Right? So that was my purpose. I mean, that was part of my purpose for going to England in the first place, was to show you guys, you know, as a bit of a demonstration. This is how you create a future possible event. What they call a virtual event, right? This is how you make it a real event. Because when I was in Bournemouth, that was the physical world. I was a physical person. I had a physical audience there. I made a recording of it with my phone. It's all physical. But when I first had the thought, it wasn't physical. It was an idea. It was non-physical. It was just a thought in my head. Hey, wouldn't it be neat to do this? Right? So that's what I wanted to mention last week, and I didn't get to it. The idea that when you're working in the workbook, think about it that way. Because you're going to be alive, hopefully, 5 years from now, right? And you're going to be doing something. Your health's going to be in a certain place. Your relationship's going to be in a certain state. Your finances are going to be in a certain state, you know. Use your intuition and figure out what it is. You can decide, oh, I want my health to be better. Okay, what do I do? If I'm healthier 5 years from now, how did I do it? Well, I stopped doing this and I started doing that, you know, kind of a thing, right? So that then becomes a goal. Because when I realized that I had a date for my talk in Bournemouth, I realized that in December, just as I remember, it was like December 23rd or something, December 22nd, just before Christmas, I had that Zoom call with the people in Bournemouth, and they said, do you want to talk on the 2nd of May? So I said, yeah. So they said, okay. So now I had a date and I had a place, right? So then I started filling in the blanks. You know, I started looking at plane tickets, train tickets. I bought a rail pass for England. You know, I started looking at hotels, and you know, so then the process became more sort of mechanical, right? Because I had the place, I had the date. May 2nd, 7 o'clock in Bournemouth. So then the question just was, okay, well, where's Bournemouth, you know? How do I get there? turns out it's a really nice place. And so that process, right, of working in the workbook and planning something out, there's sort of two sides to it. One is like, what do I feel is coming up? You know, what would be a great thing to have happen? And the other part of it is just technical, you know, okay, what time are the trains? What time are the planes? How much are they? How much are tickets? You know, whatever, right? Which bus do I take to get from the airport to my hotel? You know, that sort of a thing, right? So, and what I said in that talk, and what I've been saying to you guys, I hope, many times, is that you can create. You know, you can create your dreams by communicating with your future self, right? Any thoughts there? Any comments?
I think I really go ahead.
No, you go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I think the one thing about that really stood out to me was that you picked a date, right? Like you kind of created a now it has to happen moment, and then you started filling in the blanks. And I think that is really helpful. I think a lot of times people get stuck in the details and then they think they have to create a date or set something. Whereas if you create the date, it's on. Like now you've got to get her done. I think that was what stood out the most for me.
Well, I didn't pick the date for Bournemouth.
Okay, but they did or whatever. Somebody
they did.
Set that date for you. Yeah. And now you had to work out the rest.
Yeah, right? Once I had the date and once I had the place, then it just became automatic, right?
Yeah.
It became like any other goal that you achieve, you know. So So there's the two sides to it. One is sort of trying to figure out using your intuition to figure out, because the whole thing started with a thought in my head that, hey, wouldn't it be neat to do a talk while I'm there? But I decided, you're right, I decided in December I want to go to England this year, right? Or at least next year. So Naomi, you had a comment?
Yeah, I like the frame of the workbook, keeping a diary of the future. I think that's a good frame. That the workbook is keeping a diary of, and I never really looked at it that way, but that's a really good way to look at it.
It is. It's a different way of looking at it, right? Because if you look at it from this standpoint, like looking to the future, goal setting, oh, I want to do this and I want to lose this weight and I want to earn this money and I want to have this kind of relationship. And, a lot of it is just kind of you're coming from the present and you're projecting forward. Whereas the other way, you're sort of thinking, when you realize, hey, the future's going to happen anyway, right? Like I mentioned last week, I said, if I hadn't gone to Bournemouth and if I hadn't contacted those people, that room would have been occupied with another speaker and another audience, right? Because they do those talks every Tuesday. So it's like that's going to happen anyway. I just put myself into the picture by contacting them and asking them, would you like me to talk? And they said, yeah, we have a space on the 2nd of May. This was in December, so this was like 5 months away, 4.5 months away, right? So one of the things that I notice, and I notice it quite often, is that when I'm talking about this whole process, I forget that I didn't always believe this. I didn't always know this, right? I mean, I can remember when I decided or when I realized, hey, thinking is a connection. Memory is a connection. Goal setting is a connection. Well, before that, when I was 32, I didn't have that thought. But that answered all my questions, right? Because if thinking is a connection, then that explains why ESP works. It explains why telepathy works. It explains why goal setting works. It explains why you can remember what you did yesterday. So that's literally what thinking is. Thinking is making connections with all these various places in inner space-time, right? But I didn't realize that until I realized it. Before I realized it, I just thought, memory is like taking a picture of the past and that's it. But once you realize that it's a connection, then you realize, well, there's a place beside it, right? In other words, there's the possibility of being in Bournemouth on May 2nd and not doing a talk. Which would be like a parallel future, parallel reality, right? So when you realize that, then you realize, well, there's parallel past realities too. I remember getting my degree in university. Well, I can imagine not getting the degree or getting a different degree, right? Or going to a different school if I'd gone to a different university, got a degree from Simon Fraser instead of UBC. So once you realize that, then you realize, well, the past is always there and the future is always there. That's when I came up with that model of, that map of inner space-time, right? That we talked about last week. That's the key to the whole thing. So there's a couple of other basic points that I wanted to mention because if I'm not careful, I forget to mention them. And then if people don't have these concepts, then what I'm saying doesn't make any sense to them, right? So one of the concepts is that a thought is a real thing. Like you've heard that before, maybe thoughts are things, right? You've heard that, Phil? Thoughts are things?
Yeah, I heard that.
Yeah. So what does that mean, thoughts are things? Well, if it's real, if it's a kind of real, like I call it a virtual event, I got that from physics too, because in physics they talk about virtual particles. Well, a virtual particle is a particle that doesn't exist physically, but it has a physical effect. Right? It's a little bit like a magnet behind a screen. You tie a nail on a piece of string and swing it in front of the string, it's going to move because the magnet's there. You can't see the magnet. As far as you're concerned, there is no magnet. But if you can see the nail moving towards the curtain there, then you go, hey, there must be something behind there that's attracting it, right? It's the same kind of a deal. So that's a virtual event. It's not physically real, but it has a real effect. So that's what a goal is. In other words, when I got that date and that place, Bournemouth, May 2nd, 7 p.m. That was a virtual event. That was in the future. It wasn't real. But it had a real effect. I started buying plane tickets, buying train tickets, reserving hotel rooms, because I knew that at some point in the future, all things equal, it was going to happen. And I was going to be a part of it. I was going to be, that was a physical event that was going to happen, and I was going to be there. It was going to be a physical event in my life. So it started out as a thought in my head. Hey, wouldn't it be nice to do this? And then it ended up on the 2nd of May. Boom. Here it is, physical reality now, right? Now that's magical. So those thoughts, those goals, those ambitions, those ideas, they have a kind of reality to them. In the East, they say if you're walking in the woods and you see a stick on the ground and you think it's a snake, the fear is real. So in other words, that stick is a virtual snake. If you think it's a real snake, you're going to be afraid. But there is no snake. Right? So a goal, especially a goal, has a reality to it, right? So I'm going to share my screen here for a second. This is my PowerPoint, right? Here's a quote from Saint Augustine. Now, Saint Augustine was a philosopher. He lived in the 4th century AD in North Africa, right? And this is what he said. Time is present and measured by the mind. The past and the future are in the mind. In our consciousness, the past and the future have a being of sorts. So that's what, 1900 years ago almost, right? No, 13. Not being a math whiz. So this is the 21st century, so 17, right? 1700 years ago. So this idea that thoughts have a being of sorts, right? They have a reality. That's what he's trying to say. He said the past and the future, they're real. They have a reality of sorts. So this isn't my idea. I mean, you know, I didn't come up with this idea. I just realized it. I mean, people have been talking about it for, you know. Buddha said you make your world with your thoughts. 2500 BC or 500 BC. So thoughts are real. Kehoe says, you know, my thoughts are real forces. So I talked a little bit last week, I mentioned this phrase, bending reality, right? So my reality bent when I planned to go to England, and then I had that date, May 2nd in Bournemouth. My future changed. My reality bent. I was on a different track now because I knew I was going to be in Bournemouth on May 2nd. So I started to work towards that, right? I fitted into my schedule. So my belief, when I had that dream when I was 10, what I said to myself was, whatever this is that's happening with me, it must happen to lots of people. They just don't notice it. Because I'm just me. I'm not a, you know, I'm not a psychic. I'm not Nostradamus. I'm not a prophet. Because being raised in the church, you know, that's what I thought. Saints, they can see the future. Prophets, you know, they can predict the future. They can read dreams. Right? Joseph, he can read the Pharaoh. He can interpret the Pharaoh's dreams, right? And we dismiss all of this by saying, well, yeah, but they have a special power. Those are special people. And my thought was, I'm not a special person. I'm just me. Whatever this dream is that I had that's pointing to my future here and explaining my future, this must happen to lots of people. They just don't notice it. And I believe that more, you know, after 65 years since I had that dream, I believe that more and more every day now. But we don't, but we mislabel it, right? We don't know what it's called. So now I call it, oh, being your future self. But St. Augustine said, oh, it has a reality of sorts, right? So these labels that we use, ESP, intuition, psychic ability, opening your third eye, all of those things, all of those labels, as far as I'm concerned, they all are describing the same process. And we tend to think, oh yeah, well so-and-so can do that because he's got ESP, you know. Or so-and-so can do this because he's got a talent. He's got a talent for music. That's why he can play the piano. They forget, oh yeah, but he practiced for an hour a day for 15 years, you know. That's what his talent is, right? So this process of having a thought, turning it into physical reality in your life, that's something that everybody can do. You did it last time you went to the store and bought a loaf of bread. So last week, I mentioned the fact that I started off thinking that this memory is a connection. This was in 1980. So my analogy was a phone call, because that's what I was thinking, right? It's kind of like a phone call. You're making a phone call to the past. You're getting information from the past. That's memory. That's a connection, like a phone call. If I call Phil in Vancouver, then I get information coming through the connection, right? So for the last, you know, 40 years, roughly, I've been using that analogy of a phone call. But I thought of a better one, which I mentioned last week, that think about the internet. You know, a lot of people say that your mind is a computer. Well, if your mind is a computer, that's one way of thinking about it. But think about a computer that's not connected to the internet. You lose 95% of its ability, right? Because we use the computer now to connect to different places on the internet, like we're connected right now on this call, on this Zoom call, right? So if you expand that a little bit, see, I have this thing right here. This is a computer that's connected to the internet. See, here it is right here. Have you ever seen one of these? So what does it have? What does it use? Phil, what does my phone use? What makes it so powerful and effective?
Well, it is a full computer. There's more computing power in it than the Apollo, missions that went to the moon. You know, I mean, they.
But how does it do it? Like, how do we harness that computing power?
We turn it on and we open it up and we follow the protocols to access its.
So what do you call those things? What do you call these?
Well, those individual icons there?
Yeah.
No, they're links.
Yes.
They're links to,
they're apps.
Whole library of capabilities. Yeah.
They're apps, right?
Applications.
So I have an app on my phone that says YouTube. I click on it and I go to YouTube. YouTube is this huge library of things, right? Videos. I have another app on my phone that says weather. I click on the weather and it tells me the weather. I can say, what's the weather in Toronto? And it just, it downloads the information from Toronto and tells me the weather right now. YouTube doesn't do that, but my weather app does. I have another app on my phone that records my voice and will transcribe it for me. That's another app, right? So here's a better analogy, I think, of what your mind is and what thinking is. Instead of thinking of your mind like a computer, thinking of it like a phone call, think of it like a computer with a bunch of apps. Right? I'm going to share my screen again here. So here's the pipeline of the imagination. This is the phone call I was talking about, right? Can you see this? Phil?
Yep, I can see it.
Yeah, so there's the inner self and there's the outer self, right? Mm-hmm. Well, think of that as an app. Like that connection to the inner self, that's an app on my computer, on my phone, in my mind. So I call that my inner self, right? Now the inner self has two parts, the past self and the future self. It's like, if I use that weather app on my phone, I can get the information about the weather from Toronto or the weather from Beijing or the weather in Vancouver or the weather in Shanghai using the same app. So if I'm using my inner app of my past self, then I can say, what can I remember that makes me feel powerful? What can I remember that makes me feel loved? What can I remember that makes me feel satisfied or talented or attractive. Okay? To me, that's a much better metaphor. Because my mind will do that. Because I have this app called, my imagination that's connected to all the parallel realities in my past, you know.
So think of that workbook and the various worksheets in the workbook as apps for your mind. One app, the past successes list, triggers your mind to search for positive experiences in the past that have specific success energy. The worksheet Master Dream List triggers your mind to search in the future to look for areas of your life that you would like to improve in the future. So that workbook can be considered a series of apps for your mind, a kind of a software for your mind.
Likewise, part of my inner self is my future self. So to me, that's a much better analogy to what thinking is. And if people don't have that concept of the map of inner space-time that we have, then it's not going to make any sense to them, because they're going to, the only thing that they know is that, oh, the physical thing happened and I have a memory of that, but I don't have a memory of anything else. But you certainly do. You can imagine that it didn't happen, right? You can remember past events as well as you can remember events that didn't happen. It's exactly the same process. Your mind just goes, oh, well, what if I'd gone to Bournemouth and the place that they were going to have that talk was closed that day? Maybe there was a fire. I can imagine that. I can go there, and I was going to do a talk here tonight, and there's nobody here, and there's a sign on the door saying, sorry, we're closed, there was a fire. Building closed. I can imagine that. So that was a possibility, too. That was a virtual possible future. So to me, that's a better way to think about what thinking is. You have a computer, you're connected to the internet, you have these different apps. Now, if people don't have the app that says future self, then they're not going to be able to do that as well, right? So, I remember reading sometime in like 1980, just after the computer was invented, you know, I had a little computer, had a Mac, and I thought it was brilliant. I could, you know, draw pictures on it. I could type. I could create documents on this computer. And I remember reading that in the future, we were going to use our computers to connect to other computers, and one line that I remember reading, like I say, this was 1985, 1990, something like that, I can't remember. And it was a story, and it said, in the future, you're going to be able to watch any movie or any TV show or listen to any piece of music that was ever recorded. You're going to be able to listen to it instantly on your computer. And I thought about that, and I thought, that doesn't make any sense. You mean I can watch I Love Lucy or my favorite episode of, you know, The Love Boat anytime I want? Well, guess what? Now you can, right? Because we have the internet, we have these connections, we have these things called servers, you know, that accumulate and record and connect to all these different sources of information, right? So that's a much better analogy of thinking, I think, than the one that I learned when I grew up, which was I can remember something that happened in the past because I have a picture of it in my mind, so I know what happened. But the future, I don't have any information about the future because the future hasn't happened yet, and there's no way that you can know what's going to happen in the future. Which is the model that a lot of people have of time and the mind. How, Buha? That's Chinese for, is that good or not? So I think if you get that model, you know, that when you think, this is what you're doing. You have this thing in your mind, which I call the imagination, which is a connection, right? And the other end of it is like a search engine. It's kind of like Google, right? I can ask Google a question and it'll go out and it'll find it somewhere on the internet, right? It doesn't matter where it is. It could be a website in China, it could be online dictionary, right? How do you spell this? You know, this word, it'll go online dictionary. Here's the word, right?
Well, I think I want to plunge here a little bit.
Plunge away.
Well, I'm getting, after listening to this, I'm just, you know, reflecting back on my own inner process, which, you know, I think I'm devaluing the importance of my own thoughts in the sense that I'm looking outside, you know, I'm constantly looking for information. You know, fascinated by the news, by things in history, you know, video discussions. You know, they're all created, you know, by other people. Well, what about my own inner reflections and taking some time for that? And so you were talking about a diary, you know. I'm going, why the fuck do I, excuse my French, why have I never put much, you know, focused energy on having a diary? You know, like at various times I've picked, you know, had a little, you know, little diary book, and, you know, I run out of gas in a few days, you know, and then I, you know, then I'll pick it up 5 years later and make some new entries. I mean, it's like, you know, and that's what this workbook is. You know, the same thing with the workbook. You know, I've fiddled with it a little bit, and now I'm getting, you know, why didn't I take that time for myself? You know, maybe I'd have more focus, accomplish more if I, you know, create that energy and create those future events that I'm working towards, those goals. I got a lot to do here. I got a lot of catching up after 79 years.
Well, that's right, you know, but it's not too late. I mean, you can start today, right?
Today Naomi, is the first day of the rest of your life, yeah.
Naomi one day said she had this insight that a goal was a future past success. Well, that's brilliant, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, me doing a talk in Bournemouth on May 2nd this year, 6 weeks ago, whatever it is, that's one of my past successes now. It's on my past successes list. Man, when I think about that, I feel great, you know? But in December, when I first talked to Sue Stone, and she said, do you want to speak on 2nd of May? Actually, it was Anita, her friend who runs that group in Bournemouth, she said, do you want to come on May 2nd? We have a space there on that Tuesday. That was a goal. to go there and be there and do that talk. Well, now it's a past success. So we're creating our past successes. So one of the most powerful aspects of that workbook is your past successes list. And like I said, I think of it now kind of like that weather app, you know. What can I remember? What success did I have where I felt powerful, that I felt creative, that I felt loved, that I felt lucky? And just start writing them down. So you have a big advantage, Phil, because you have more past than the rest of us. Your past is bigger than mine.
Yeah, yesterday you said lucky. I just remember the one time I won a raffle.
Write that down.
On Whidbey Island, yeah.
Exactly. Write that down.
That was a win.
Yeah. And I predict if you close your eyes, and you don't even have to close your eyes, but if you just think about that for a minute, you'll remember another time that you were lucky. And then you'll remember another time that you were lucky. And if you do that a little bit, you make a habit of that, then pretty soon you're going to feel luckier than you've ever felt in your life. Yeah.
Well, I also, when you say, I just had flashed on the other side, I mean, in a sense, some very close call lucky misses of being in a car accident.
Absolutely. Like, yeah, me too. You know, I'm lucky that I didn't get hurt there. It was in this accident. Nothing happened to me, right? So I'll just share my screen again for another quick moment here. So this is Wallace Wattles, right? Science of Getting Rich. Actually, he wrote that book, Science of Getting Rich, but this quote is from another book that he also wrote called The Science of Being Well, I believe. Any faculty, power, or talent you possess may be increased. You can multiply the brain cells in this particular area until it acts as powerfully as you wish. The man does not make the brain does not make the man makes the brain. So that's neuroplasticity. He wrote that in 1910, I think.
Wow.
And here's Carl Jung, right, talking about the future self. He said, the Swedish psychologist Carl Jung proposed a very intriguing idea to the phenomena of the future self. In his theory, your future self already exists, or your future already exists. That future version of you is trying to manifest itself in the present moment by directing your attention toward things of interest. It stands to reason that your interests are ultimately what you become if you focus on them. So whatever you're drawn to or deeply attracted to in your daily life, it could be your future self trying to come alive in the here and now. So that is what I meant when I said a few minutes ago, you know, that thinking of goal setting, not like you're sort of projecting, oh, wouldn't it be great if I had this? Instead, think about reading your future self. Like, what am I doing 5 years from now that's really fun? And that was actually the thing that triggered me to start looking for a place to speak in England when I was thinking of my trip. Because I decided to have a trip to England. And then one day I was thinking about that and I thought, hey, wouldn't it be great to do a talk there? And I, of course, immediately what came up for me was, how do you do that? You don't know anybody there. You don't have any contacts there. You know, how can you possibly organize a talk in England, right? And I thought, well, how much fun would that be? And it was like, yeah, that would be so much fun. So that was the thing that got me to say, yeah, let's put some energy into manifesting this one. And thinking about it now as a past success is like, wow, you know, I can brag about that forever, right? Of course, I don't brag. I'm not a braggart, but thinking about it certainly makes me feel good, right? Plus, I have a whole bunch of new friends there. I have a new connection there. I'm already thinking about what am I going to do on my next trip, you know, on my next trip to Bournemouth. Maybe do my one-man play, right?
How close is Bournemouth to Bedford?
Bedford is 45 minutes north of London.
Mm-hmm.
And Bournemouth is about 2 hours south. We went from Bournemouth to Edinburgh. So Bournemouth is about as far as you can go in England, as far south. I mean, it's on the English Channel, right? It's sort of southwest of London. And Edinburgh, of course, is in Scotland. Well, we went from Bournemouth to Edinburgh on the train. It took us about 5 hours, 6 hours maybe. Maybe even less, because we had to go to London first, change trains. So, not that far. And yeah, going to the house that I was born in, that was a trip too, you know. So there was another goal that I accomplished that was absolutely meaningless, probably, to everybody on Earth except me. And the only reason it had any meaning for me was because I decided it would be fun to do that. And it was fun, too. So, yeah, so just to kind of reiterate here, we're talking about the same process that I have been talking about since 1980, the idea that, you know, thinking of the past and thinking of the future are the same. And the more I think about it, the more I realize how natural and easy it is. It's, you know, creating a dream, creating a goal, is as simple as deciding to go to the store and buy a loaf of bread. So it's something that we use. So, you know, we're all psychic. We all have intuition. We all have ESP. And to underline what you said a minute ago, Phil, the key to the whole process of developing your personal power is to learn to use your inner senses, i.e. begin visualizing, meditating. Make it a practice, right? I think it's another word for prayer.
Oh, absolutely.
Prayer is something that you're familiar with, right? Being a church elder now.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
Feeling good and feeling inspired.
Yes, good.
Mm-hmm.
Well, thanks for being here. So, see you next week.
All right, great.
Bye for now.
Sounds good.
Make sure you order your free workbook today and begin designing and creating the life of your choice.